Welcome back, everybody. Here we have a photo that has been requested by a friend of mine. This is a painting that exists in a certain chapel in the Israel area, and as the print of this is not available anywhere, the best we can do is shots the people have snapped themselves. So, I am going to attempt to reconstruct this painting and remove the bright red lady who's standing or sitting in front of it. So, this is going to be another one of those videos where I might be in over my head, but it'll make a fun experiment and we can all relax together while I do it, right? So, here is another snapshot that was taken on a mobile phone. It gives me some good reference. I can see that where the picture cuts off is pretty close to where the picture actually ends, so I'm not too concerned with that. But to start off, I think I want to do a little bit of color correction on this just so that it's a closer match, and then maybe I'll use it, maybe I won't. I highly doubt I will. If you look at the yellows and the glows in this, they pale in this one by comparison. It's just not a good exposure when you take it with an itty bitty phone aperture. And this one is also lit with these spots, these recessed lights, and we don't have any of that here. So where this would make a more even exposure, it wasn't taken with the proper equipment, and so we're just going to borrow from it, maybe. But yeah, let's get it matched up. So let's move it over here, and I'll just compare skin tone to skin tone a little bit. This is all unrehearsed, so we'll see how I do. So I've created a color balance layer, and if I start adjusting it, it's going to adjust everything, and that's not what we want. We want to make adjustments just to this little sample that I've included. So to do that, we hold down our Alt key, and we can make it a slave so that when we make adjustments, it only makes adjustments to the one thing. So let's try boosting our yellows and our reds. Oh, that's pretty close. Yeah, I'm liking that a lot. It's lacking the contrast, because again, the phone aperture can't do the nice deep contrast of a proper camera. But if we go in and maybe, let's start with levels. I like levels. Now, because I created it on this, and we already have a layer bound to it, it automatically gets slaved and mastered up. So we'll just make an adjustment to our shadows and an adjustment to our highlights, and then we'll play with our mid just a little bit. Okay, I need to dull these mids. The more I'm looking at this, the less I want to play with the sample, but let's see if we can match it up just for fun, because this will allow us to use a feature that we don't often get to use. So if I hold down Shift and select both of these, I'm going to try and do an automatic alignment match between the two, just to see what'll happen. So in order to do that, let's start, because Photoshop doesn't always do it well, so let's scale this up so that they're approximately the same size, and that'll give Photoshop a little bit more to work on. Now, ordinarily, I would never scale up anything. Photoshop will try to create pixels that weren't there because you've stretched everything out, and the result tends to be a blurry mess. But where this is just a reference for me, It doesn't matter if it gets messed up. So we'll make them about the same size, and if you want to get really nerdy with it, you can grab the opacity slider and make it about 50%. And this is going to be kind of spooky. Okay, we'll try and line this up with our arrow keys. Okay, so it's pretty well lined up along that ankle now. We'll just nudge it with those arrow keys. Okay, pretty good. And then holding down shift, I'll grab this corner and try to get things exact. There we go. Pretty nice, guys. Pretty nice. It's going to have to do a little bit of work here in the middle area because it is a curved room. And part of what we're going to struggle with today is I want to create two versions for this friend of mine. I'd like to make one where it's just the painting represented in the room, and I'd also like to make another version, which is a little trickier, where there's no curvature and it's just a flat pane so that it can be printed flat and look like a flat piece of artwork. So we'll see what happens when I get to that point. I'm going to hit enter to accept those changes, and it will render it for me. I'm now going to hold down shift and select both of those because we're going to make Photoshop align them as perfectly as it can. So we're going to go to layer and nope, I'm mistaken. I don't do this very often. Let's go to, I will find it. I will find it. It's in a really funny place. I remember that much. Oh, okay. So it's grayed out. So what if I rasterize this layer? Will it then let me use an auto alignment on them? I bet it will. That's probably, yeah, there we go. So because we had this in as a smart layer, it wasn't allowing us to do an auto alignment, but it should work now. So let's try auto align layers. And we've got all these different options. Auto tends to work the best most of the time. If I had to guess, I would think spherical would be the way to go, but let's just see what it does with an automatic adjustment. I click OK, and it has increased my palette size to accommodate everything. But now, if I increase the opacity of that top layer, look at that, folks. That is the magic of Photoshop. That's the automatic tools. So if I get really, really lazy later on in the retouch, I may just borrow some of these phone assets to cover some things up, even though they look really gnarly by comparison. You can see the before and after. That's what a phone pic looks like. And if I may be on a soapbox for just a moment, I get a lot of product photography that people shoot with their phone. And if you get in close, I know this has been up-resed a little bit, but nothing compares to the nice grain of a proper camera with a large aperture, something that was actually built for photography. It just looks so much cleaner and nicer. So I don't know that I'll use this at all, but as I'm painting, at very least, I now have a reference that lets me know what was behind her. And I can hope to recreate those details a little bit. If I'm a little bit inaccurate, I don't know that my client will notice. So we'll see. Now the main thing is going to be this canvas. I don't care about all the extra space, so I'll just quickly do a trim out the transparent pixels, and I'm back to my original dimensions. So let's zoom in with a Control Plus, and let's take a look at this lady. I'm going to press Control Shift N and make a new layer, and I'll call it Hide the Lady. We should maybe give her a name. That's a good name for a lady. I don't know. There are a lot of playfully racist things that are coming to mind based on what she's wearing. But we won't go there. Let's get her painted out of the picture before I dig myself into a hole. I have a good foot here that is remarkably similar to this foot. I am half tempted to borrow details from this foot in order to recreate that toe and that sandal. Yeah, comparing this side to this side, there's a lighting difference. Our lighting is coming from this side, so it's in shadow, but just the same, I can probably borrow this shadowed sandal here for the bottom, and I can probably borrow this toe and invert it to cover that side. So I think that's going to be my approach. So starting with, what do I want to start with? Let's do the whole sandal. Let's see roughly where the sandal ends. So I'm turning this on, and I think, yeah, it's shifted a little bit, but let's treat it as though it's accurate. I'm going to press Control R to bring up my rulers, and I'll put a guideline right there. And then turn off my rulers again. So I need sandal that comes to that line. So I'm going to come down to my base layer, and I'm going to grab this entire foot. And I'm going to press Control J, which effectively copies and pastes in one step. Now I will press Control T to transform, and just as a quick way that I often do it, you put a negative sign in front of your width and it will give it a negative width. So that will give me my toe. Again, I'm going to lower the opacity on this so that I can see how things line up underneath. Just want to line up this new sandal with the old one, pressing my arrow keys. And I'm going to up-res this, which you should never do, but we're going to do it because we have to. We don't have any other resources to work with. So that's looking like the sandal is hitting that line, and it's also lining up with the original sandal. But we have a discrepancy here. I may do a whole new sandal. Yeah, I may borrow the sandal a second time in order to put that where it goes. But just for now, let's line up the toenails. The toes and the toenails right there are looking pretty good. So I will hit enter to accept those changes and bring up my opacity. So I now have this toe transplanted from here and inverted. I will add a mask to this because obviously if I recreate the entire foot twice, people are going to notice. They're going to see that this toenail matches that toenail, and we're trying to create an illusion here so that nobody knows what we did. So I'm going to add a mask to this, and I'm going to make it a black mask so that everything disappears. Now, here we go. Here's our first tricky edit. I'm going to use my upper bracket key to make the brush a little bit bigger, and then shift bracket to make my brush nice and soft. And I will proceed to paint. Cross your fingers, folks. Okay, so we're painting. It's looking pretty good, actually. It's looking pretty good. I've got to finesse that toenail a little bit. Let's come up here. I'm going to turn my mask off just so that I can compare the two. What does the original toe look like? Okay, so we have to create a line that the other toe didn't have because of the perspective change. But let's see what we can do about that. I bet we have some ways around that. I'm going to nudge this inward, about like that, so that it lines up a little better. And then I want to finesse this line a little better, too. There we go, soft brush, just painting it one more time. Want to find the happy spot on it. Okay, looking good. Okay. Oh, oh, too much, too much, too much. There we go. Nice and easy. Oh, he does, I mean, if you don't mind him having a ping pong paddle for a big toe, this probably works okay. But we'll probably do some more with it just the same. Let's look back and assess. Okay. You know, come to think of it, I may have just been saying tongue-in-cheek things about Jesus's toe, and I hope that doesn't offend anybody. I don't mean to do those things. Alright, so here we are looking at the toe. I want to add a little more girth here on the side of it. But I think we have a good start. I'm going to grab the sandal again, the entire thing, and duplicate it once more. And let's clear the mask off of it. I want this to be the original direction. Just flip that around. Because all I'm looking to do is restore this edge to where she is. I don't like the edge that we were using when we made the toe. So we'll make this about 60%. And we have two sandals at different angles. I will press Control T and move my pivot point to right there. See how my pivot is on where the both sandals are lining up right here, so that's where I want my pivot point to be. That'll give me the best result. And now when I pivot, you can see that I have all of that that's lining up just beautifully, and I can use that to paint out the rest of her blouse there and her arm. And everything down here is going to be a piece of cake. We've got plenty of ground. It's these detail areas that are tricky. I'll hit enter to accept those changes and then bring my opacity back up. So all I want is to borrow this nice piece of sandal that was painted for this picture and cover up the problem area. What I like about doing this is not really repainting the picture. I'm just reusing what was already painted a little bit. Feels like I'm being somewhat true to the artist when I treat it that way. So I'm going to paint this in. Looks like we don't have quite enough sandal, but the sandal that we do have looks a lot better, I think. There, and then paint out the part where the toe shows up. Okay, that's not bad. And we're going to have to fake this a little bit. And bring that down to where it lines up. Control T again. And just rotate that until it's looking like it's at home. There we go. You know, I'm being less and less bothered by that big toe. If you look at these other big toes, they're kind of paddle-shaped too. Alright, we'll see what we do. Zooming in again. I like it. Okay, so our Hide the Lady layer is above all those others. So as I paint in this layer, it'll cover even these adjustments that I did right here. There is a walking stick here that's going to be a little tricky. Let's start with the walking stick and then kind of go along this hem right here. So, coming up here onto the wood, grab my stamper tool, and we'll just find a nice edge, probably. Let's start right here near the top. So I grab right there, make my brush a little bit more firm, and we'll just paint along there and nudge what we did. Okay, so it's looking very green. I don't like that. I need to borrow a little closer to where I am. Let's just delete what I did and try it again. Let's grab from maybe right here. That should be in the same color family a little bit more. Yeah, we'll grab down there and make it smaller. Just paint her hair out. Doing little clicks. And this is a nice deep little groove in the staff. Let's preserve that. We'll just try and recreate that as we go. Just doing little borrowings, little alt clicks, borrow here, borrow there. Just kind of finesse it a little bit. The nice thing is this is painterly, it's not photographic per se. So as we work, we can treat things a little with a little more artistry and a little less literal interpretation. Okay, I'm coming up here. Just want to see where that hem goes. Okay, so the hem is about where I would imagine it goes. We'll see how it turns out as I try to do this. So alt-clicking on some nice hem that's up here, and your initial click is always the most important. Place that is sampled is what defines the rest of what you do. So I'm gonna go along here. Right now the color match is not great, but I do have a solution for that. So we'll see. See when I get to that point. Let me reference this again. Okay, we're gonna dive low with our hem. Gonna come up here and just bring the hem down a little bit more, and then taper it out and bring it up. Not too bad. Looks like cloth. Looks like cloth. What more could you ask for? So I'm enjoying this. I think it's good. This line here needs to be continued, so I'll borrow from here and bring that line down. Okay. And then this through here and all of this transition needs to be finessed. So I'm going to find a nice wide open thing with some neutral texture. Grab my healing brush, not the spot healer because the spot healer is automatic and I want to be able to pick where I sample from. It's very important. So I'll make it smaller and borrow from this nice big area right in here. This is nice and smooth. So alt-clicking. And I will trace along that edge, and when I release, Photoshop blends it for me. Do a couple passes just to make sure. Yep, I like that. Okay, right along here, we're going to get rid of that halo of hair. So I'll make my brush a little bigger. I'll click up here and just follow it along. Following. And when I am done, I release the button. Photoshop blends it for me. It could have done a little better job. let's hit this one again because we can see kind of some awkward shadowing there. One pass, another pass, another pass. Okay, we're getting there. Now, we don't want to be too hard on ourselves when we're working with this level of detail. If we back out, there's really nothing wrong with that cloth at all. Now, I'm having irreverent thoughts about this woman's head being underneath the gown, so let's fix that next. So here, we need to replace some sandal. Where can we get a good piece of sandal? This foot over here isn't too bad. Yeah. I don't know that I want to do that twice, though. Interesting. Okay, those are the only feet in this picture. Okay. Okay, yeah, let's give it a shot. So, zooming way in, I'm just going to borrow this whole strap and continue it a second time. Just tracing along that bottom edge, and all of this blackness is just sole to sandal. So we'll bring that in a little bit. My edges are funny, so I'm going to redo those. Okay, trace along there. Looking pretty good. In the original, what did we have there? Okay, so we have a strap, and then we have a second strap that has nearly the same curvature, but we can probably fake that. I'm going to borrow this strap and repeat it and bend it so that it's small like this one. And this is exciting stuff. Okay, so I'm going to grab all of this. Actually, before I do that, let's finish the strap that's already here, just so that that gives us less to fix once we've duplicated it. Okay, so we've got a little bit of a pattern there. I want to randomize that a little bit, just add some elements that are unrelated. Okay, maybe add a few more. Let's add some there. Okay, that's good. Now I'm feeling more confident that we can borrow this strap. So turn on my caps lock so that I can have a precision lasso and just do little clicks along the strap. Little clicks along the strap. And, okay, I think I want more of this skin just in case, so I'll hit backspace. If I hit backspace, it'll undo clicks that I've made. Let's borrow just a little bit of skin just in case we need it. And close that off. Now I'm going to press Control Shift C for copy merged and paste. So copy merged copied everything that was underneath, everything. So there we are with our new strap. Where does the strap go to? Okay, it's going to go right where her head is. So I'm going to bring that in and transform this and make it about the same size. Just about the same size. But let's curve it down just a little bit because I believe the sandal, that seems to follow the foot a little bit more, I think. Okay, so we'll stick it right there. Let's compare it. I'm going to undo, bring it like that, and let's just shrink it. Just wholesale shrink it down and compare. It's a little closer. It's not right, but it's closer. Just to add some variance to this leather strap. I'm going to reach for a tool that I don't ordinarily use. You have your dodge tool. It's all the O's. You've got dodge, burn, and sponge. Sponge is for saturation, which is the one I typically use, but let's grab our dodge. And in the dodge tool, you define what you're going to dodge up. What are you going to brighten? You can brighten dark things or shadows. You can brighten midtones, things that are somewhere in between, and you can brighten things that are already bright, or highlights. Let's brighten mid, because these are mostly shades of middle gray, and what I want to do is mimic the luster that they had in the original strap just a little bit, and make this strap stand out a little bit so it's not identical to this one. So, with my dodge, I'll turn caps lock off so I can see how big my brush is. And let's make it about that big, and I'm going to do one pass, two passes. It got a little bit saturated for me right there, I think. Let's grab our sponge and desaturate at about, let's say, 20-something percent. It bigger, and again, one pass, two passes. Okay, I'm more comfortable with that. I think it looks a lot better. Now, just to add a little more of an illusion to this, let's bring up the original and lower the opacity on it just a bit. Okay, I'm not going to be able to distinguish between those two. Yeah, I'm not. But one thing I can see already is, even though this is a shorter strap, it's a little bit wider at the base than what I currently have. So let's make it a little wider, give it a slightly different curve than it has, and it should look like a unique strap. So I'm going to hit Control T again to transform. And I'm going to use something that I believe was introduced in Photoshop CS5, which is what I'm running, the warp tool. So it applies a little bit of a mesh over what we have, and I can do little stretchings. Let's stretch it so it's wide at the base, but then it gets really skinny and curved. There we go. I like that. Okay, so we'll hit enter to commit those changes. And there we have it. That strap looks much different than this one does now. The highlight along the front end is a little bit of a giveaway, but we're going to put flesh tones over part of that, so it should be less easy to recognize. So I will now merge this layer down into my Hide the Lady layer. And, oh, look at that, guys. We're performing miracles. This is so great. I know I shouldn't joke about performing miracles when we're doing a Jesus picture, but you gotta admit, pretty fancy. Right? Pretty fancy. So I will grab my stamper tool again, hold down my Alt key, and let's just paint that nose out of existence. Very nice. Very, very nice. I like it. Okay. So, that being said, I wanna, let's see, smudge this a little bit. Yeah, No, I take it back. Smudge is going to be a dead giveaway on this particular picture, so. What can we borrow at this point? Because I don't want to recreate the shoe piece by piece. It's too much work. That is kind of a unique angle on that sandal. We've got part of a toe here. That toe's at the wrong angle. This toe might be usable, actually. Let's try it. I mean, we've got time. You guys aren't doing anything. Let's do this. Let's grab that toe. And Control-Shift-C to copy merged, and we'll paste it. So we've got a copy of the toe. It's going the wrong direction, so we'll hit Control-T and reverse the width on that. There we go. Now, I just want to see if I can... I think I can maybe sell this illusion. Let's hide it underneath our Hide the Lady layer, so that when we bring it in, it goes underneath our brand new sandal strap. And making this about 50% opacity, let's see if we can put a toe in that sandal. Control T again to rotate. And let's find a good angle for this toe. Right about there. Okay, I want to match. I need to match the size. So let's make it, I think it's bigger. Yeah. This will work. Okay. So now I will bring it to the top of the stack and make it fully opaque. So I've done a lot of work in recreating the sandal underneath all of this. I want to preserve that. So if I hold down the control key when I'm clicking on Hide the Lady, that is a perfect selection of everything that I've painted to cover her up. So in having this layer selected, if I hold down the Alt key, I can make it remove those things immediately, like that. So right there, I can already kind of see what my end product will be. But let's bring up the brush and paint out the remaining areas. So that sandal is going to need some work. I may reverse that. Let's not paint that for now. We'll just get rid of all of this extra up here. Firm up my brush. Come down. Come down. Come down. There we go. And now a soft brush to introduce the new toe. I do like that. I do. Okay, let's paint a little bit right over that piece of her face. Preserve the strap, though. Okay, smaller brush. Let's just focus on the sole for now. And I will smudge my mask to kind of introduce one into the other a little bit. I'm not smudging pixels, I'm smudging the mask. See, you can see my mask, how I've done that. Never show another person your mask. Your mask will always look sloppy, so keep that a secret. In fact, now that I've seen it, I'm going to clean it up so no one knows what I did. Alright. So that right there needs some dark pixels. Let's go to hide the lady, grab our stamper tool, and fill in some of that with the darker flesh tones that are right here. Okay, I like that. Backing out, assessing what I've got. It's pretty good, pretty good. We've introduced some elements over here. I gotta get rid of those. Hide all of that. Hide it, hide it. Okay. So now, like I said before, we've got the two straps and they look kind of identical, so let's fix that at this point. So going to my layer here, I'm just going to add a little bit of toe color over the top of that white highlight, so that the only one that has the white highlight is this one. We'll add just a little highlight back in, just a little bit. Very nice. Very nice, I like it. I do like it. Okay. So now we'll paint some toe. We've got a little bit of a highlight along this and along the bottom, so let's paint more into that. Oops, the opposite of that. Okay, so right along there, right along that bottom edge. Looking good. And then I'll grab my smudge and just smudge my mask in just a little bit so that it blends. Just blending my mask together. Cool. You know, guys, I don't think anyone would think those were the same toe. I think we're pretty good magicians. So I'm going to zoom in, and I do want to remove the highlight on it because it is in the background. It's being shadowed by some of these other people. So I'll grab my levels and I'm just going to darken this down without saturation. Just darken it a little bit so that it's not standing out so much. Try to find the right balance there. In there. Yeah, we're just muting the toe a little bit. Because we're magicians, we're trying not to call attention to the changes that we made. So I think that's going to be key to hiding it. Okay, I am okay with that now. I'm okay with that. I'm going to apply this mask so that everything that I did with that toe is now self-contained, and I do like it. Let's grab this dark area of sandal so that we can continue it upward. So grab all of that, Control-Shift-C for a copy merged, and paste. Bring it over. Lower the opacity just a bit so we can get them lined up with each other. And rotate. Okay. I like that. All we're concerned about is this edge here. I want the sandal to stay dark as a background element. So I hit enter, raise my opacity, and let's paint it into place now. So I'll get a good size brush. And let's start right there. Yep, that'll keep it dark. Very nice. Very nice, very nice. Cool. Oh, that's exciting, guys. It's coming together. It's a little slow, but it is coming together. Let's find the layer that find the layer that adds that hem. Okay, it is that layer. Okay, so again, making a perfect selection of what I painted in the Hide the Lady layer, I'm going to trim this edge so that it's what it needs to be. Just like that. Perfect. I like it. So now, scrolling down to the bottom, if I alt-click this eyeball, we can see everything that we've done so far. It's slow going, but we are getting there. Did I not fix this sandal? I could have sworn. Oh, okay, there we go. I wonder why that was turned off. Cool. So now we will finish off. Let's finish off this walking stick, and then we can replace all of this with stone. I think the hard part's over, guys. I really do. I grab all of this with my marquee, and Control-Shift-C, and paste. And I'm going to invert it so that we have good wood material to work with on the other side. And the trick will be to not make this look like a mirror image. Okay, so in the original painting, the bark came a lot lower on the left side than it did on the right. So let's try and mimic that. That'll add some good variety. I'm going to take this whole thing and drop it way down here. Get it rotated though. So I'll set my rotation point right there so that it moves around that point, and we'll try and line this up so that the bottom of the staff has the correct width. Shrink just a bit. Well, do I want to shrink it? I guess I do. Yeah. But I'm going to shrink it from the top so that this comes down a little bit. Down to right about there. And make sure that our rotation and our blending and everything is looking good. Just for kicks, to add some variety, what would happen if I make it skinnier? Pressing my arrow key to shift this over just a little bit. Line up my new pivot point. Let's find a good width for this. Right about there. Right about there. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. It's good. It's good, guys. Okay. Now we're going to paint out things that we don't want. So I will add a mask to this now, bring up my brush, and this edge right along here. I don't want to replace any more of the art than I have to. So yeah, we'll get rid of this entire center line that's creeping over. Just painting it out with black on our mask. Paint it out, and let's see if we can line the bark up right here. You know what, guys? We're pretty good at what we do. Yes, indeed. Look at that. Look at that. I like it. Okay, we need to blend this bark into that bark. So we'll come along the top and just paint down a little bit. And we have a bit of a color transition. This is in a highlight, and this is in the shadow. So to preserve this going downward, let's see. Okay, so her shoulder starts pretty soon. I'm going to grab the smudge tool, and let's smudge these pixels downward and try to create transition. If we go too far, yep, okay, we're starting to see blouse. So we'll push it back upward, just blend those pixels together. Cool. We're close. I'm now going to fudge this edge just a little bit because it is dark. And I'll do that by grabbing a new solid color layer. It's going to black out your screen with whatever color you've used previously. I'll use this one for now. That's probably fine. I'm going to turn it off for a second. Let's sample this color right here and paint some over this to lighten it up a bit. So I'll invert this mask, double click on that to bring up my color picker again, stray over here, and let's grab a nice light brown. Really light brown. In fact, let's go lighter than the picker did. Right in there. I like that. Turn the layer on, select the mask, and use a small, soft brush. Well, pretty big brush, actually. Yeah, let's do that. Let's slave and master these two up so that we don't make any mistakes and paint out things we don't care about. And we start painting. Alright. Now you're going to say, Adam, that looks like crap. Well, you have to start with crap. It's just the way it goes. Now that I've painted that in, let's lower the opacity quite a bit. Way down. Right about there. Turning it on and off. Okay, so that definitely helped our shadow thing. I don't like what it's doing down here. I think it's neutralized those contrasts too much, so we'll grab my handy smudge and use my favorite smudge brush, which is the one that's like a million little fingers, which is perfect for what we're about to do. And we just smudge with a million little fingers. And we create a nice transition there. I like it. I don't think anyone would be the wiser on that. So I probably need to finish up the bottom of this sandal. I need to remove a little bit of coral from the toe area here. Yep. So let's do that. Come down. I should have labeled my layers, guys. I knew better. I knew better than to not label my layers. You can see why it's so important. Okay, grabbing my stamper, making it a little bigger. And Alt-click, and let's paint that out. Let's paint some more stone into place. Looks like we're borrowing a sheetrock wall or something there in the background. Control-R to bring up my guides. I just want a guide that kind of defines where that wall is supposed to be. So now if I select right along the edge of this table to there, and right along to right about there, that is the space that needs to be replaced with sheetrock. Get my guides out of the way so I can see a little better what I'm doing. We've got lots of real estate over here that we can borrow from, so I'll get my stamper, make it a little bigger, borrow from this dark area. Is it a good match? Oh, it's not a good match yet, but we can adjust it. And I'm going to paint from left to right. And again. So right now, because of the flashing marquee, I really can't see very well what that color looks like when compared to what's around it. I press Control H and that will hide the marquee. I can press it again and bring it on and off, but that way I can see what I'm doing. So with just that selected, we won't be making adjustments to the rest of our Hide the Lady layer, just to that section. And we will try to, oh, that's so close, guys. So close. Good. Good, good, good. Okay, I'll have to fudge the edges just a little bit, but I think that's serviceable right there. Not bad. Okay, we'll hit Control H to deselect. Then press Control D to deselect. And we'll go here and just smooth that edge. Smooth it out. That edge doesn't bother me. Let's get rid of that little bit of dress that's coming out. Just paint along there. Paint right along that edge. And zoom out. Good. Oh, she's almost gone. Oh, she's got legs too. I didn't notice those. We'll get to the legs. We'll get there. In fact, let's just get them right now because everything's so fast at this point. So I'm going to grab my stamper, make it pretty big, select right along that edge. That edge is a good guideline. And we'll start way over here with our edge. Make our stamper nice and big. We can see where it's going to apply it. And we'll just paint those legs out of existence. So we've got a repeating pattern. We've got these two eye shapes that are repeated. So I don't like leaving traces of what I do. So I alt-click here and we'll just kind of add a little bit of randomness to that pattern so that no one's the wiser that we made changes. Very nice. Okay. Now we have a little bit of floor to take care of. So I'm going to select the opposite of what I've painted. And we'll just paint more stonework over that area where she's sitting. Do-do-do. And borrow from here a little bit and cover that. And borrow from here again. This is just our base coat. We're just roughing it in a little bit. Okay, borrow from here. I think that's good enough for now. Okay, that staff edge needs to not be square. So I've got my brush, I'll set it to hide and just paint gently along that. Now I can focus on replacing that stonework and it won't look goofy. Yeah, that's good. Good, good, good. I need to get the bottom of the staff again though. Let's see. Now I can see clearly what I need to replace. Borrow that. Paint a little bit under there. Do we have any other sources of stonework? We have a little window right there that we can borrow from. I'll borrow low right there and paint left to right. This in with our smudge. We'll just smudge the mask a little bit. There we go. And we'll keep hiding the lady. Keep hiding. Here we go. I want to deliberately pick a new spot though. I don't like that highlight. Let's just borrow and staff is still causing me grief. There we go. Okay, so we'll grab this stonework here is pretty good. We'll just paint there. And grab some of this dark stuff back in the back. That, do that, do that, that, there we go, just borrowing, just trying to get her out of there. We're so close. Okay, so here we have a line that ought to be continued. Let's mess with that a little bit. Go back to the staff. Hide a little more of the staff. Go back to the lady hiding layer and just continue this little highlight through. Down here, paint some more. Sorry if it feels like I'm rushing. I'm thinking at this point it'd be best to just get things finished up. So, okay, so I've painted very sloppily there, but what this will allow me to do is go down. Here's my sandal layer. Let's remove that highlight. Good. Okay, good. Good. Let's keep messing with this sandal till it looks perfect. Yeah, let's keep messing with it. So we'll just finesse that edge. Very nice. How's it looking? I like it. Okay, the lady is gone. Let's worry about removing things that we took a little bit of a cannon with a mosquito technique on this. Oh dear, I covered up my wood. I'm gonna have to do the wood again. Gonna have to do the wood again. I should have used a new layer. I knew better. I knew better, guys. I knew better. Anytime you're experimenting, feel free to start a whole new layer for that experiment. Don't compromise what you've already done. Don't. Was so close to being done. I really was. Okay, so now we will hide the lady all over again in that one spot. So let's start with the crease. We'll get this nice craggly part of the wood and just paint it down. Continue that line. Grab the edge here and paint upward. We go. It's a little jittery. I'll fix that in a minute. Set this to 20% and just add some nice wood details to what we see here. Do this, make a nice firm brush, and let's define where the wooden staff actually exists. Okay. Nice big generous brush there. Nice generous selection. With a soft brush, I will paint these details in. Let's just hide that edge. That's all we're looking to do, just hide the edge. Hide that part too. Just doing little finesse work now. Little finesses. So now I want to apply a layer to create a transition here. I want it to get darker. I want it to get darker fast. So for that, I'm going to select all this right here. And let's use a levels layer. So levels. So that levels now has that perfect selection in it. I'm going to select it again because I just realized I goofed. Let's grab the gradient tool so that it starts bright and gets darker. So we'll take our gradient straight back like that. And we will start to darken. Darken more. American. Now, if we look in close, you can see that my line is too perfect. It's not believable because it doesn't have any dithering to it. So we'll right-click on the selection and refine the mask. I'm just going to apply a light feathering to that. See what I did there? Let's do before and after. So before, after. Nice and gentle. Blends better, looks better, is better. Wow, I think we did it. I think we did it. It took a lot longer than I wanted it to, but we got it. So let's go down to the bottom and see our before and after. Before, after. And it looks like magic. It looks like we didn't even do anything. And people will look at what we did and say, "Oh, how long could that have possibly taken?" Well, now you know. You've seen it done. Now, I want to save this, so I'll save it. And then I'll also save a copy. So let's make this the non-lenticular one. So what I'm going to do now is an obvious cheat. So I've got the document opened right now. Let's close it. And we'll open this document again, but we're going to open it as a Camera Raw document. So it's going to be opened as though we were opening it in Camera Raw. It's a good idea to have your documents open that way by default if you want to just do minor corrections. I do 90% of what I do just using the Camera Raw controls. So we click open. This gives me access in Adobe Photoshop CS5 to the lens correction controls. I'm hoping that this will solve our problem automatically. The problem being the fact that the room is curved. Let's try it. Oh, guys, look at that. Look at it. Now, oh, I don't have a terrific eye. Let's see. Let's make sure that we're nice and flat. I seem to have a flat horizon on top and bottom, so I'll say open image. I'm going to save this. That was insanely easy, actually. That was insanely easy. So I'll get my crop tool and just double check that everything is square. Bring that up to there. Okay, and square that up. So we're going to trim a little bit for this version, but that's okay. We'll provide both versions. And hit enter. And there it is. There is our extremely high-detailed, hand-photoshopped, Red Woman removed version of this painting. So thank you very much for watching, guys. This was a lot of work. Hopefully it was enjoyable and relaxing. And take care. I'll talk to you next time.